Alrighty, welcome back. 8:35. Halloween just hours away. Trick or treating going on tonight. And joining us this morning, a real pro when it comes to this time of year, R.A. Mihailoff joins us. Good morning, sir. How are you today?
Good morning, Luke. Good morning, Mark. Nice to be here, fellas.
It is good to see you.
Great to have you. Now, we've been working on this for what? 12 years?
Well, no, Luke, it's not that long. Come on, I haven't even known you that long. But it's been a while in the making. Here's the big problem. Generally, I'm not around here this time of year.
You're a busy guy. But hey, listen, before you get into that, we got to get your background a little bit.
Okay.
Where'd you grow up?
Townville, Pennsylvania. Proud of it.
Now, how did you end up on the screen? I think this is quite a story.
Well, you know, I started in high school, and you've heard that expression, a big fish in a small pond. I was a whale in a mud puddle. You know what I mean? I mean, I was a, you know, an unusual combination of athlete and actor, you know, which the two groups, and back in those days, the two groups didn't, you know, usually mix. And I just had a lot of success in high school, and it encouraged me. I thought about going to, some kind of prestigious acting school. I even maybe thought about trying to go to Juilliard, but dashed those hopes real quick-like. And so then I just kind of got disillusioned with the whole thing and went out and worked on the Erie Lackawanna Railroad. I worked at Meadville Malleable Iron. That kind of stuff. Worked on cross-country oil exploration. I picked them up here. I picked them up here and ended up going down to Mississippi on the Gulf Coast with them. All kinds of stuff like that. And you know, I just felt I had to go out and get some life experience. And then I was back here, and I was baling hay for Bonnie Cook, who used to run the Meadville Community Theater. And, you know, how it is on a farm, you have a great big lunch, and we were eating one day, and she goes, R.A., you're going to be in my play I'm doing. I said, yes, ma'am, I will be. And from that point, so I was in my early 20s by then. From that point on, I got re-energized, met the head of the drama department at Allegheny College. He invited me to come up to Allegheny College to do a show. And from that point on, it really started to, you know, gear up again and you know, all the engines running on all cylinders. So I went to acting school at the Cleveland Playhouse, met a lot of actors close to my age that were instructors at the school. They encouraged me to continue. They gave me some leads. I got my first paying job, I think, in 78, 79, I don't even remember. That's the fog of time is too far back. But anyway, so from that point on, I started to build the momentum again and eventually made my way to California, dug in, determined that I would either come home in a Mercedes-Benz or a box.
Wow. I couldn't imagine what that's like. I mean, California, that's where I got to go. And you just did it.
Yeah, but I had a lot of friends from, I ended up working a couple seasons at a an outdoor theater in Chillicothe, Ohio, and met some really good friends who are still my friends to this day. And actually, if anybody's a fan of Sons of Anarchy, one of my friends from that group, one of my best friends from that group, played the role of Jury, who just got shot on Tuesday.
So you pick up the phone and say, hey, I'm sorry, man.
Yeah, I did. Well, you know, I called him up because I knew he was on the show, and I called him up and said, come on, man, what's going on? I can't tell you. You know, they were contractually bound that they couldn't, discuss the plot.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. And we're really good friends, and he wouldn't tell me. So, you know.
So when you hear, and there's so many kids today that are going through meeting with guidance counselors, and they say, you know, I have a dream, and somebody says to him, well, you know, you're from Northwest Pennsylvania, maybe you shouldn't, maybe you should go this direction. What do you say to that?
Well, I'm going to steal the corporate slogan from Nike, just do it, for one thing. Also, remember, this area is a fertile breeding ground for talent for some reason. Sharon Stone, Todd Holland, you know, Sharon Stone from Sagertown, Todd Holland from Meadville, and I'm sure there are many others that I'm not even including right now.
You had a fascinating story about Greg Nicotero, who hails from Wexford, down Pittsburgh area.
Yeah.
You know, and I was just watching Halloween, I think 4 and 5 were on last night, and his K&B group did some special effects and makeup work on that. Of course, now he's involved with The Walking Dead, but you know these guys. I mean, you talk about an area of talent.
Oh yeah, I mean, you know, I mean, no, okay, let's broaden it out. Northwestern Pennsylvania, holy cow! You know, George Romero, Greg Nicotero, Tom Savini, go on and on and on. John Russo, you know, all those guys. You know, thanks to Night of the Living Dead, which was one of the seminal horror flicks of all time, if you ask me. You know, I think in chronological progression, maybe Psycho started the ball rolling, and then jump up a couple years, and then Night of the Living Dead just, you know, turned everything on its ear, and then the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre. So, in that pantheon of horror, tent poles, Northwestern Pennsylvania plays very deeply into that.
Tell us about that phone call you received to be a part of the Texas franchise.
Oh, well. it was before the days of cell phones and everything, and that group of people I talked about earlier that I moved to California with, we got associated with a bunch of very talented filmmakers from USC. So we formed this group of this very supportive group of actors and directors and things, writers and things like that. So everybody was at a 4th of July party except me at one of the people's house, and they're all film geeks and everything. So of course, when they found out that Jeff Burr got the assignment to direct Chainsaw 3, they asked him, you know, they started talking about it, and they asked him what you know, what was he going to do, who was he going to hire, and Jeff Burr is very respectful of our industry, and he felt it was appropriate to offer the role of Leatherface to Gunnar Hansen, the original, which is what he did. Unfortunately, for Gunnar, good for me, Gunnar was unable to successfully conclude a deal with New Line, which left the part vacant. And at the party, the consensus was, well, who's, you know, what do you think about R.A.? Perfect, you know? And so from that point on, it was sort of, it wasn't a done deal, but I was certainly in the loop. And quite frankly, had I not made that relationship back in the USC days, I never would have gotten in the room. I never would have been seen for that part.
Wow.
And that goes back to something I said earlier, just do it. You know, you can't sit around with your hands folded, oh, I want to be an actor, or I want to be whatever. You just can't sit around and dream it or think about it. You have to do it. You have to get on your feet. If you want to be an actor, you have to act.
What's your favorite part about the filmmaking process?
Oh, payday. Lunch.
There's an honest assessment.
It's great. They treat you like a king. You get paid very well. When you go to work, you have your own little dressing room that has, you know, a table and chair and desk and little, can I say this on the air, toilet. And a little day bed to lay down on. The minute you go to work, it doesn't matter if it's 3 o'clock in the afternoon or 3 o'clock in the morning, they have food ready for you.
Wow.
And 6 hours later, they have to give you a formal meal. The first food is just something, you know.
Gets you warmed up.
Yeah, to warmed up. And then 6 hours later, under penalty, a financial penalty, they have to break you for an hour for a really nice meal. So that's all good, you know. And you're usually surrounded by lovely young people that call you sir.
Wow. But at the same time, you guys are putting in a ton of hours every day.
Okay, yes. That's... when you can lay down and take a nap for half the day, is that really that bad?
Well, no, but...
you know what I mean? I mean...
But a lot of it is waiting for, what, it's setups and...
Hurry up and wait, sure. Probably of, say, maybe if a 12-hour day, if you end up doing a 12-hour day, you're actually on your feet working maybe three of those hours. The rest is all waiting.
How much of the final product is so much different than what you are envisioning in your head while you're performing?
So much. So much. You know, even in a... So let's take a horror movie, for example, since it's sort of the hook of today's show.
Yeah.
Even the most gruesome, brutal, nasty, vicious, violent horror movie scene is relatively tame when you film it, in the sense that... just like here in the studio, there are cameras, cables, lights, monitors, people out, you know, doing things. It's the same with a movie, you know. You may be chasing somebody through the woods with a chainsaw, and it looks like it's pitch black, but it has to be lit, you know. It has to be lit so you can see it. You have to watch, you have to step, you know, you got to make sure you don't trip over cables, you know, and stuff like that. Follow, you know, the camera track, and... also, they're grilling steaks over at the lunch wagon. Oh boy, let's hurry up and get this scene done. You know. Also, you know, and without the sound effects, it's amazing how much sound effects and music add to the film experience. You know, the raw footage. Quite often, you know, I don't set in dailies too often. I rely on my directors to tell me if I'm doing what needs to be done. But when I do set in on the raw footage, it can be kind of boring, you know. And it's when you layer all those elements together. It's the quick cutting, you know. The editing, that adds a lot to it. The music, like I said, the music, the sound effects, everything, you know. And that's what... The final composition is what makes it exciting.
This time of year, especially, you mentioned that typically you're very busy going to festivals, horror festivals, and just taking part in various things. In addition to, you know, being an actor and working on a set. But when it's time for you to relax, do you enjoy popping in other horror movies, or do you go to a different genre?
Oh, I love horror movies. Always have since I was a child. So, you know, I watch every horror movie that comes on TV. I generally don't even go out to a theater in general public, just because I don't want to have to yell at somebody for talking, smack them upside the head, and then end up in jail, because I can't stand that. So if I go to a theater, it's usually for an industry, you know, an invited industry screening where it's a very partisan crowd, and, you know, you're going to get a very good film experience. Otherwise, I just generally watch them on, you know, cable. But I like horror, of course. I like, believe it or not, I like Westerns. You know, The Searchers is one of my absolute favorite movies. There are certain movies that I'll watch over and over again every time they're on. The Searchers is one of them. Believe it or not, Paint Your Wagon.
Really? Wow. How about that?
Yeah. I don't know. How can you not like a musical about prostitution?
Hey, I wanted to ask you.
Yes.
You've been in the business so long, it must be a little bit different making a movie now than it was, say, a few years ago. What's one of the differences that maybe strikes you the most?
The pace has picked up quite a bit because of the new you know, cameras and things like that. Everybody's switching over to the digital stuff, so you don't need to light them as extensively. You can move faster, so you know they've whittled it down, especially on the lower budget stuff, they can crank them out real fast.
I imagine the editing is a lot faster now, too.
I can't really speak to because I don't have a lot of experience in the editing room, but I'm sure it is.
Does that make any difference to you out on the set, you know, what kind of equipment they're using?
No, not really. I mean, you know, your job as an actor is to read what's on the page and interpret it through the prism of the director. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So that part of the process, in my opinion, is pretty much the same. You know, and again, even though we're talking about speed, we're still talking about long periods of inactivity. Mm-hmm. It's a business where. Brief periods of intense activity followed by long stretches of, well, I don't want to say boredom, but because only boring people get bored, right? Of inactivity, you know?
Well, I've heard it said, I spent some time in the military, and I've heard it said pilots will tell you, especially fighter pilots, will tell you that it's hours and hours and hours of boredom punctuated by seconds of sheer terror. Okay. So it's got to be a sort of the same thing.
Well, yeah, except not as dramatic, not sheer terror and not sheer boredom, you know. But yeah, hours and hours of waiting for brief periods of intense activity.
Wow. Now, are you still doing ghost hunting on the side?
Yes, I am. I'm trying to think. My group, Hollywood Ghost Hunters, in August, we made our first convention appearance as a group at Michigan Paranormal Con. We didn't investigate anything. You know, we just made an appearance and did workshops and stuff like that. Kane Hodder, Rick McCollum, and I are still involved in our group. We're angling for our own show, but so far that hasn't jumped off.
The shows that are out seem very popular, and it seems like that would be something that a network would be interested in.
You know, I could go bald scratching my head about this. But I don't know. We actually shot a demo with a big production company, and it just it didn't jump off. It's a mystery to me why we don't have our own show, to tell you the truth.
Well, you know, you should get a lot of credit. You're a professional actor. You're doing what you love to do. You get to travel the country. You get to. You probably have been overseas to do some things. I think you said you go to Canada quite a bit for various conventions.
Well, I've been to. October 4th was my first official. That was my first international appearance at a convention at the Hamilton Comic Con.
Wow. But you must run into some very interesting people.
Oh, come on, Matt. Back to Hammer. I love that name, Hammertown. Back to Hammertown Comic-Con. That Saturday night, I had dinner with Hacksaw Jim Duggan, Mean Gene Okerlund, and Howard Finkel. How can you beat that?
Wow.
You know?
Wow. Oh, my.
And then Louis Ferrigno, you know, was at another table, and it was a lot of fun, you know?
That's incredible.
Yeah.
Have you ever thought about sitting down and writing a book about your life?
No. People have suggested that, but man, I feel like I got a little bit more stuff to do before I.
Well, you've experienced so much already. I mean, I know you just continue to be busy, and there's a lot of great things happening.
I'll kind
of,
you know, maybe I'll if I would ever do that, maybe I'll wait till I'm like, you know, on my deathbed, and I'll dictate it. to my secretary. All right, honey, come over here. let me tell you about the old days.
We're nearing the end of this year, getting ready for 2015. Got a lot of projects in the works, or is that something that sort of just comes when it comes?
It comes when it comes. I've signed with a new manager, Judy Fox Personal Talent Management, and she is great. So I'm looking forward to a really a very productive year with her in my corner now. She's been really beating
aggressive,
the drum. Beating the drum for me and knocking on the doors, and so hopefully before long.
It seems like an interest in horror films has really peaked again after maybe, you know, I don't know, 90s. I think it kind of maybe started with Blair Witch. And, you know, when people look at that and say, wow, you know, we can do a movie on this budget and it can be so successful. You know, now it seems like it's popular again.
You know, it's a roller coaster cyclic, you know. It's really, as a matter of fact, when I was getting ready to come down here, I was watching AMC.
Yeah, and Fear Fest.
Yeah, and they were playing these old, half-hour shows from the 50s, 60s, whatever. And there was one, How to Make a Monster. And it actually, it was a fictional account of... I was a teenage werewolf and I was a teenage Frankenstein, two titles I remember from my youth. You know, I mean, used to read about them in Famous Monsters of Filmland. But the hook of the story was a new company was taking over the studio and they were going to quit making horror films. Horror films were, now remember, this is the 50s. Horror films were over. They were done, you know, and, it's so, you know, even back as far back as then, it's always been up and down.
And people just like to get the bejeebers scared out of them.
Yeah.
They do. I love that. I love turning off the TV. Even last night, like I said, I watched, I think, Halloween 4 and 5. And you turn the lights off to go to bed, and you take that extra look around the corner. But it's something about, you know, a movie that just, I don't know, tugs at your emotions, you know?
Yeah, and I've heard it said that the grimmer economic times are, the more appeal there is for escapism, you know? And I think that's true. You know, you read accounts of movies during the Depression, you know? They were gangbusters, you know, because people wanted to get away from their personal life, their personal problems, go sit in a theater for an hour and a half. And I think it's the same now, you know?
You get the phone call to play either Leatherface, Michael Myers, or even Jason. Which one do you go with?
Oh, Leatherface, of course. for the simple reason that's how I'm built now. Here's a little interesting tidbit. Speaking of Jason, I was actually considered for the role of Jason in Number 6.
Really?
Yes. Got a call from a good friend of mine, Jim Winburn, who's a stuntman. And trained me, and he called me up and he goes, "Hey, R.A., a friend of mine's producing a movie. I don't even remember if he told me the name of the movie, but they need a big guy to play the killer. And I told him about you, so call this number." So I called the number, and it was Paramount Studios, and I got summoned to Paramount Studios to the studio bungalow of Frank Mancuso Jr., the executive producer, sat on the couch in his Hollywood bungalow, knee to knee, discussing the role of Jason. And I think I must have known the stakes were pretty high, because I remember that morning when I was brushing my teeth, I almost puked. I was so nervous.
Oh my goodness!
Oh wow!
Yeah, you know, because I knew that was a kind of a big deal, and. You know, a drive on pass to Paramount. You know, usually nobody actors don't get drive on passes, you know.
Yeah.
But this was kind of a big deal because they'd already hired a guy and they had shot him out for 2 weeks. They didn't like what he was doing, so they decided to recast the role of Jason. So, like I said, I had my meeting with Frank Mancuso. It went well enough that he passed me on to the director and stunt coordinator. And I hit it off with the stunt coordinator really well. And so he and I exchanged phone numbers. I waited for a while, didn't hear anything, called him, the stunt coordinator, up. He goes, "Hey, man," I said, "I was rooting for you. I wanted you, but the director wanted the other guy." So the other guy got it.
Well, again, the fact that you've been involved in so many productions and you continue to perform and you're doing what you love to do, I think that says a lot, doesn't it?
Yeah, I'm very fortunate.
Do you have some projects that are going to be released? I'm just looking at it. This is so cool that you can go online and read all about you.
Well, you know, I've got here's my one of the favorite things I've done in the last several years. Here are my three favorite movies I've ever done: Texas Chainsaw Massacre 3, of course. Hatchet 2, because it was a, you know, the part was written specially for me. I got to work with my good friend Kane Hodder. Tony Todd was in it. John Carl Beekler, the special effects maestro. Danielle Harris. And the guy I call the father of Chucky, Tom Holland, who wrote and directed the original Child's Play. But before he became a writer-director, he was an actor, so he came out of acting retirement to co-star in this movie with us. So that was a very, very cool project. Plus, we got to go to New Orleans, you know, to shoot, and that was like that was our wrap party, you know.
Oh, wow.
we got to New Orleans about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, went to the hotel, dropped our stuff off, and probably stayed out on Bourbon Street till 4 o'clock in the morning.
It was, oh, wow.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. So that was my second favorite. And now this movie, Smothered, which again co-stars my good friend Kane Hodder, me, Bill Moseley, best known for his work on Devil's Rejects. What is it? Otis.
Yeah.
Don Shanks, who was Michael Myers, number 5. Malcolm Danar, who was Moochie in Christine. And we had cameos from Tales
from the Crypt Casino.
Oh, wow.
he was in it. Michael Berryman was in it. And here's the best part. It was written and directed by John Schneider, Bo Duke from Dukes of Hazzard.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. It's a horror comedy. And he turned out to be the greatest guy in the world. I was having so much fun down there. I actually stayed a week later just to go motorcycle riding with Schneider.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, we shot it in Louisiana. So then I've got a couple others I shot last summer. I shot one called The Taker, which my favorite part about it, it had not one, not two, but 3 Playboy Playmates in it, including 2013 Playmate of the Year.
Wow.
So that was a lot of fun.
You mentioned working with Danielle Harris, who
yes.
was in 4 and 5 Halloween and the remake, Rob Zombie's remake
yes.
of Halloween. Was she nice?
Oh, yeah. I love her. You know, I mean, she did, when she was a little kid, 10, 11 years old, and she did the Halloween 4 and 5. I remember her because it's the same time that we did Chainsaw 3. So, you know, I was watching all the entertainment shows and stuff like that to see me, but I saw her, you know, and I was very impressed by her when she was a little kid, you know, and then to see how well she grew up. She's beautiful. She's, you know, all that poise, that intelligence she had as a child just exponentially blossomed, you know, and she's a tough little chick, man. There was, you know, we were shooting a scene in the swamp, and she had a pistol, an automatic pistol, and the slide came back and pinched the web of her hand and cut it. And, you know, when you're making a movie, you have to have an EMT, and the EMT came over and looked at it and asked her if she wanted to go to her trailer. She goes, nah, just put a Band-Aid on it and let's keep shooting.
Wow.
Yeah.
Ari Mihailoff, it has been great to have you on the program. Happy Halloween.
Happy Halloween to you, Luke. Mark?
And the same to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. I've had a blast here today.
Please come back anytime you want.
Let's make that a done deal.
All right. Excellent. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, a round of applause for Mr. Mihailoff this morning joining us. And again, happy Halloween. And check him out. A lot of great films. Check him out online. You can see his entire body of work. And we continue to follow you. It's a real pleasure. It's always fun to see you.
Thanks, Luke.
Alrighty. Hey, a couple minutes past the hour of 9 o'clock. We'll be back here tomorrow morning at 6 for Daybreak News. And, of course, 7 to 9 for the Morning Drill, the Friday edition. And it is Halloween, so maybe we'll turn a few studio lights off tomorrow, Mark. we'll get too scared. And, of course, the final football game of the season tomorrow night, too. We'll tell you all about that tomorrow. Have a wonderful Thursday. Watch out for the trick-or-treaters tonight, and we'll see you back here tomorrow morning.